If it wasn't for the sake of medical science, you wouldn't be talking to me right now.
This ever-rising line of growth. It's time to think again.
Degrowth strategies.
Dr. Dommerholt, break down for me what exactly degrowth is.
So we can be prosperous because they are not. And that's not fair. I mean, we need to radically change our system. It is unrealistic to think that we can keep on doing what we have been doing so far, because to chase your purpose means to chase more stuff. Mm-hmm. And to chase more stuff is
endless.
Yes. And we know that people are trying to fill a void.
Did you have that void ever?
It's a good question.
That saying just gave me goosebumps. Dr. Dommerholt, you're the first person that I have on my podcast that is, I want to refer to as doctor. I think that's a massive achievement. I want to thank you, first of all, for your time today. And I start all my podcasts with the same question because I feel like it'll establish how the rest of the conversation is going to continue. And that question is, are you happy?
I'm happy.
What, in your opinion, is required to live a happy life?
Have a stable family situation.
Interesting.
I'm happily married. I've got a wonderful wife, wonderful kids. Mm-hmm. I'm happy. Got a wonderful job, fine colleagues, great students.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
For this podcast, I try and use it almost as research. And my guiding hypothesis for it is passion equals purpose.
Okay.
What are your thoughts on that?
Passion equals purpose. That's a very nice question. I think there's a lot of truth in there. Because if I just reflect on myself, then what I'm passionate about is also giving purpose to my life, or is a reflection of what I consider important. So yes, I'm passionate about what I'm doing, about passionate about my profession, also as a professor here at the Hans University.
Yeah. Do you believe there could be downsides to chasing your passion?
Downsides, not from my perspective. I mean, if you're chasing your your purpose or your passion, it should always be done in a fair and honest manner. I mean, but there are no in my view, there are no downsides to it.
No, that's what I'm looking for.
There are no downsides. Specifically, because my passion is, professionally speaking, about degrowth, and that is very contradictory to harming people. Mm-hmm. So, if the passion is about, well, not even, but even improving the situation in which people live, then, I mean, that should also be ingrained in how you perform and how you behave.
Upon researching your background, it seems like you've been working in sustainability long before it even became a topic. What first attracted you to this industry?
Well, first of all, I'm a macroeconomist by training. And I've given economics topics, subjects, courses for many years. I've been a teacher now for 35-something years. And what I increasingly started to dislike was the idea that we always need more and more and more, and nobody can actually tell me why. Because we are already, well, I don't want to say happy, but we have reached a high level of sufficiency. Mm-hmm. So we have more than enough. So why then should we need more than we already have? And whilst there are so many people elsewhere on this planet who simply pay for that price, the price for our prosperity are paid by people somewhere else on this planet. And that's not just. I mean, that's not fair.
That saying just gave me goosebumps. That's never even thought about it that way. And I think most people don't. Did you ever find an answer to that question of why we feel the need to have so much?
Oh, yeah. I mean, to be honest, I also discussed this, of course, with my wife. And my wife was actually one of the first, because she's a trained nurse. She's not an economist. And she asked me, she said, well, tell me, why then do we need to grow? And I came up with the standard answer. I said, well, we need to grow because we need to create more prosperity.
Mm-hmm.
And we also need to create more jobs. And to create more jobs, we need to have better healthcare systems. And we need more money for that. And more money comes from growth. And she said, well, but it is good as it is right now, isn't it? I mean, so then, why then do we need to grow? I mean, if we have reached already high sufficiency levels today, then, and that goes back to, well, I'm married for almost 40 years now, so it goes back 40 years. Well, but why do we then need to grow? And I, honestly, I couldn't really give her a good answer to that question, but it kept on going through my head.
Yeah.
Well, why then do we need to grow? And at some point, say, well, we don't need to grow. I mean, this whole system of production, if you come to think of it, it is bizarre. It's really bizarre.
So for those that don't understand, break down for me what exactly degrowth is.
Degrowth, if you want, well, a definition of degrowth, it is a planned reduction of resource and energy consumption. That is, so it's not necessarily aiming at decreasing, as it is sometimes also referred to, prosperity, but decreasing resource consumption and energy consumption for good reasons. And at the same time, we have to find our way to come to terms with our natural environment. So we need to go back to a situation where we live in harmony with the living world. And lots of people, as I already mentioned, lots of people are actually paying the price for our prosperity, particularly in global South countries. So there is also a huge divide, a disparity in prosperity. So we can be prosperous because they are not, just with a little sense of exaggeration. And that's not fair. So we also need to work on the inequality, on that divide worldwide, but also in our street, in our city, in our region, wherever. And that is basically what degrowth entails. It's not what people sometimes also tell me is it's so negative.
Mm.
We need less. No, it's not that I'm not striving for less.
More efficient use.
Not even efficient, because efficient is basically an economic term. But it is like that we build an economy that is better than growth. That our children can be proud of, that we can be proud of, say, well, okay, this is our heritage for generations to come. Because if you look at what we are leaving behind now, I mean, it's crisis, crisis on crisis on crisis on crisis. I mean, what good can come from that? And that's not what I want to leave to my children and my grandchildren.
Yeah.
If I may have any grandchildren in the future. So that's not what I want.
So does it then focus on avoiding crises, or?
It is, well,
in an ideal situation, no?
Basically, if you just look at the situations we are in now, it is the nitrogen crisis, the climate crisis,
yep,
biodiversity crisis. We've got a lot of crises at hand, and In my view, the whole phenomenon of economic growth, which is very much related to the capitalist market system, is to a large extent responsible for that. Because growth requires that we buy low, sell high, make a profit. And it also means that nature is subdued for the sake of making money. And that's what we see, for example, in the nitrogen crisis. I also hear questions that, okay, what's then the value of an animal? Huh? The value of a squirrel, the value of a tiger. What's the value of a tiger? Well, the economic value of a tiger is zilch, isn't it?
Not,
well, it's not true. It's not zilch. It is, when you kill a tiger, I mean, you can still use it as a rug.
Mm.
And the rug has economic value because you can sell it.
Mm-hmm.
But what's then the economic value of a tiger? I mean, even asking the question already shows how far we actually drifted away from, let's say, our purpose, from our initial situation that we lived in harmony with the... I mean, go to Indians. Indians will never ask that question.
Which one, sorry?
The question, what's the value of a tiger?
Ah, okay, yeah.
Or what's the value of a cow?
Yeah.
But we do.
Yeah.
And since we say, well, we don't value tigers, we can't add a price tag to it.
Mm-hmm.
It also has no value, no economic value. And since it has no economic value, it's worthless. And yeah, if then tigers go extinct, okay, then who cares? Because they don't really have economic value. I mean, I may be overstating or exaggerating bit, but that is basically a bit how the economy works.
Yeah.
I mean, the economy, our market economies in general, I mean, they do not incorporate ethics. Got nothing to do with ethics. I mean, markets are an allocation mechanism. You buy, you sell, prices are determined. And the stuff that's being traded, I mean, markets don't care because they are simply mechanisms, whether these are potatoes or bicycles or guns or women or children.
Yeah.
Markets don't care. They don't care because how could they? They are simply mechanisms. But that's where we kick in. I mean, we have to bring in the ethics. And
the markets are also largely influenced by our emotions, right? My mind instantly goes to the Elon Musk example in which he smokes a joint on the Joe Rogan podcast. And as a result, the Tesla stock dropped by like 20%.
Yeah.
Isn't that similar then to the economic markets?
Well, I think you have to distinguish here, and here speaks the economist, between the real economy, that is actually the trading of goods and services, and the, call it the financial economy. And that's what you're talking about. I mean,
right.
The financial economy has become hugely important, whilst to many economists, the financial sector is actually overstated in the economy. And that starts back in the 1970s, where the financial sector was also counted as part of gross domestic product. Before that, it wasn't part of how gross domestic product was calculated, and now it is. So just imagine that if a housing crisis like we had in the 2000, or actually preceding the housing crisis, it's selling subprime mortgages, which actually was devastating for lots of people.
Yep.
It harmed lots of people. When that selling of subprime mortgages contributes to GDP, it's actually, well, not the same, but it was actually fraudulent behavior of banks. So fraudulent behavior then contributes to GDP. And if it and GDP is a measure of prosperity.
Yeah.
And you can imagine that politicians are not likely to say, well, we should limit the importance of the financial sector again. So, but then you're also having this bit of an ethical discussion. if then fraudulent behavior contributes to GDP, what then does actually GDP reflect? And that is a discussion that has been going on for 50 plus years.
Mm-hmm.
And GDP measures prosperity, is supposed to measure prosperity, but it doesn't really measure prosperity. It measures stuff. That's what it measures. And that's also where the dagger kicks in. I mean, if we measure stuff, the price of stuff, then I mean, where then does the tiger fit in?
Yeah.
Or a story I often tell also my students is the story of a nice summer's day. We had also a very hot summer this year, and just imagine you sitting with your girlfriend on the seashore, having enjoyed the day, went out Amsterdam, The Hague, wherever, had a wonderful day, a lovely dinner. And now you're holding hands together, sitting on the seashore, seeing the sun go down, sipping a glass of wine. And when I ask my students, I say, well, do you recognize the situation? They say, yes, we do. But what is the value of it? And then they tend to say something in the range of, well, this is priceless. Yeah, it is. It is priceless. But for economists, it's worthless.
Yeah.
Because we don't measure it. The only item that counts here is the glass of wine, because that was bought, sold, contributes to GDP, and the rest doesn't. So GDP also has all kinds of counter effects. I mean, if you want to contribute or increase GDP, our level of prosperity, then you simply have to pollute more, because if you can pollute and that causes prices to drop, so if you have a company that can or is allowed to pollute and not having to invest in equipment that prevents pollution, then the cost for selling its product can also be lower. So its market share can even be bigger.
But it seems then like, maybe I'm thinking too simple, but the simple solution to what sounds like more or less all of the problems is that the people responsible for pursuing, let's go as far as calling it criminal action, or at least harming the planet when they probably shouldn't, overproducing, that should be taken in the law in order to stop people from doing that.
Yeah, well, that's true, and in many cases that is also the case. I mean, we have.
To interrupt. If I look at the housing crisis that you talked about in 2008, I think what one banker or at least was followed for his action, or at least their roles in it, and other than that, the majority got off the hook.
And what's even worse? I mean, we're having the same situation again as we had back then. And that also has to do with our economic system.
Yeah.
I mean, what happened then will happen again. The only thing is when.
Yeah.
Perhaps not in the near future, because you and I, we remember 2007, 2008. But in due course, 10, 15 years perhaps, when people don't know what the crisis then, what it really felt like, it may simply happen again. Now, if our economy grows in real terms, so more stuff, more products, more services, then we also need more money to buy these goods and services with. Now, these goods and services, or this money, actually comes from the banks. And banks are the only institutions, businesses, that are able to create money out of the blue. So the more we grow, the more debts are created, the more likely the situation that we're trying to prevent will happen again. And that's simply ingrained, you might even call it a flaw, of our economic system. So in my view, and that's also from a degrowth perspective, banks should simply go back to their original function, and that is the intermediary function. Well, you have people who have surplus liquidities, you have some who lack, actually have a lack of money, need money, and banks are simply the intermediary between parties,
yeah,
and not being able to create money themselves anymore. Because that, in my view, in the long term is devastating. But then again, having said that, if banks do not facilitate economic growth, then economic growth will also falter.
It's like a vicious circle.
It is. And so, and that's also why I am very fond of the term degrowth, because it urges us to start thinking differently.
Yeah.
It's not just making a few tweaks here and there and trying to keep the system as it is in order, but just with some minor changes.
Yeah.
I mean, we need to radically change our system because this simply doesn't work anymore. And I already referred to degrowth is, primarily by planned reduction of energy and resources. And that's for a good reason. Because, and I just looked it up a few days ago. The copper reserves that we have are sufficient for the next 40 years. 40 years. And we still have an energy transition to come. And this energy transition requires loads of copper, just to mention one thing.
Mm-hmm.
We simply don't have the copper. We simply don't have it. And that's only copper. But for oil, we simply have 40 years to go. For iron ore, we have something like 70. Coal, we have in the range of 150, perhaps 200 years. But then again, we know what coal does. I mean, if you just burn it, well, it comes with CO2 emissions. And these CO2 emissions already are going way out of control. So we should limit also our use of fossil fuels and turn to renewable energies. But the paradox here is that if we want to build all these solar panels, all these wind farms, all these what have you, requires resources and energy. And this energy is not renewable energy, but comes from fossil fuels. So the paradox is, if we want to build wind farms, we are usually dependent on resources we're trying to avoid.
Right.
And that's a bit bizarre. So we have no alternative. Well, the same basically. So I'm also
the alternative would be, it's never going to happen, but it would be to go back to how we used to do it, right? Get a wood oven in your house instead of using gas for your heating. Or
what we need to do, and I don't exactly want to or necessarily want to talk in terms of final products already, but what we need to do is to go and redefine our consumption system, our consumption pattern. Mm-hmm. So what we need to do is focus on the needs. What is it that we really need instead of what we really want?
Yeah.
And we need to focus on the needs instead of the wants. And talking about production, and that is what production should be focused on needs. I mean, we have abundant definitions of needs, and we can come up with a needs framework, I mean, in no time. And that's not a problem. But what we need to move away from is the wants. I mean, not just buying simply because your neighbors have it, or simply because you feel like it, or like in our in Western economies, because we have way too much money to spend.
Realistically speaking, do you think that's doable to get people to move towards that, to understand that it doesn't matter?
It's not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen in the next 10 years.
What?
But
it might need to happen in order.
Yeah, but the point is, realistically speaking. And that is a term that I object, because realistically speaking, we need to go through this transition towards, in my view, degrowth economy. That is a realistic view. It is unrealistic to think that we can keep on doing what we have been doing so far, because we know it didn't work. If you just look at what it brought us, ultimately, I mean, what Einstein already mentioned, I mean, the system that brought us what we have now is not the system that also going to make the difference. Or in slightly different terms, but so we need to reform our system.
Yeah.
I think that is the only realistic option. The question then is it feasible in a couple of years? No, of course not. Because what we have been doing so far is we have come, ever since the Industrial Revolution, we've come to embrace industrial production and economic growth and prosperity and money over value, and that's not going to change overnight.
Ironically, you know this as an economist undoubtedly, one of the key things about when financially investing is that you need to do it for the long run, right? The longer time you have, the more money you earn because of compound effect. Yeah. Ironically, though, it seems like their people are forgetting this in this problem because they don't see that maybe taking the loss now and realizing, yeah, it's not feasible, but it's necessary in the long run means you get another 200, 300, whatever years, as opposed to just not being willing to sacrifice this for the short run.
No, absolutely right. But that also reminds me of a statement by the famous economist John Maynard Keynes, who said, well, in the long run, we're all dead.
Yeah.
And that is also one of the, well, implicit arguments, perhaps, people use. Say, well, okay, in 40, 50, 60, 100, 200 years, I mean, I won't be around anymore.
Yeah.
But your kids will, and next generations will. And of course, another thing is, I mean, it's so hard to put aside what we have come to cherish.
Mm-hmm.
And that is.
But that isn't.
Stuff.
Yeah.
I mean,
in your example about saying at the beach, people clearly say those events, those are priceless.
Yeah.
The when you're lying on your deathbed, you're not going to remember that you bought a Gucci bag or whatever it is.
No. And so, then what counts then is relationships and looking back on your life. So how did I invest? Well, also an economic term, but did I spend enough time with my family, with my wife, with my children? Did I take care of this planet well enough? I mean, could I have done better than what I... It's not about how much money you have in your bank account. I mean, it doesn't really matter.
No.
It doesn't really matter. So what matters is, yeah, basically purpose. What is your purpose in life? And if purpose coincides with stuff, then you almost have a kind of an explosive mixture, because then to chase your purpose means to chase more stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And to chase more stuff is...
endless.
Yes. And we know that people are trying to fill a void, well, in their hearts, in their souls, whatever, by buying stuff. And it helps for, well, 2 hours, 2 minutes, 2 days, perhaps 2 years, and then it's gone. And then you need to buy more and more and more.
Did you have that void ever?
That's a good question. It's a good question. I must say, in my younger days, I also had this. I felt this because I felt because that's the economy, how the economy works. And if you want to be appreciated and respected, you need a big car and you need a big house. But I also had my part of sufferings. I have been in hospital for quite some time, also recently, and also years before that.
Sorry to hear that.
Yep. If it wasn't for the sake of medical science, you wouldn't be talking to me right now. So I'm very much aware of the vulnerability of life and what really matters. Our daughter, she had breast cancer when she was 27. Well, as a parent, I can tell you that really hurts. That really hurts. And that makes an impression. So what then really matters? Is it about... No, it does. Stuff doesn't matter. So...
Is that when that transition occurred towards degrowth, or was that already before?
It was already there long before I actually started to promote it. But I'm also in a position to promote it right now because I'm a professor now.
Yeah.
And I'm a professor. I also have the liberty to do this. As a teacher, of course, I can explain my choices. I can show what my purpose is or discuss it with students. But that is, the impact is fairly small. Now I can set up a research program which is founded on this very topic, because I think this is the only way to go. This is really the only way to go. And it also has to do basically your purpose also very much relates to your belief, to your personal beliefs, your values. Where do you derive them from? And I'm a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
And I try to live by the gospel. And my question is, what is actually God expecting from me? And to me, there are two things that stand out. And the first thing is that we need to care about our neighbor as much as we care for ourselves and care about ourselves. And that neighbor can be my neighbor next door, but can also be my neighbor in Africa, which is perhaps even a statistical number somewhere, but he's my neighbor.
Yeah.
And we need to take care of each other. So care has become a crucial term, care. So we need to care for people, but also need to care for the planet. And if we take care of the planet, if we care for the planet, we also take care of the people. If we care for the people, we care for the planet. So it's basically unity. And that is also my drive, is this is the, call it a commandment. Say, these are the good words. Do this and you will thrive and the world will thrive. And I believe they will. I mean, if I help you, I'm reaching out, not just helping out for the sake of, that I expect something back, but mm-hmm. something helping out. I mean, if we just would do that, just help each other out. I mean, just look at the world that we would be able to create. But it runs so much counter to what economy preaches. The economy says, I want to do good, but only in a condition that it pays off. How much do I get for it? No, but that's not how life works. I mean, life is about relationships. It's about a relationship with you, with people, with with nature, with my family, with my neighbors, with, and creating the good life. And the, creating the good life is that we all prosper. All prosper. That children can play outside without having to think, can I do this because, well, the air is not clean. The air that I breathe is not clean. No, of course not. That's not what we want. That's not the world that we want to live in. So creating a world that's better than growth is actually also, well, basically in my genes, has always been. And now I'm getting in a position that I can actually tell this. The only thing is, if, and well, you're now sort of asking what actually should drive, what's your purpose, and well, this is my purpose. And I cannot see or detach my purpose from being a Christian, from my firm beliefs. That is something that is sometimes difficult to discuss, because if people ask for it, then I'm also open about it. Mm-hmm. But you can also embrace degrowth for other reasons, simply because if we go on the way that we do right now, the planet will survive, but we may not. I mean, we go beyond sufficiency, and beyond sufficiency, well, you can already call that greed. And we want more. We want more. Why do we want more? We want more.
Isn't it just because the neighbor has more? The grass is always greener somewhere else?
Keeping up with the Joneses. And perhaps also believing it makes you happy. Having more stuff makes you happy, but it doesn't. It doesn't. I mean, I once read a story about a woman on one of the dumps in Cairo. I think it was Egypt. No, but Brazil. But anyway, it was what we call a developing country. Although Brazil can hardly be called a developing country anymore, but in those days it was. And people are still living on dumps, also in Egypt. And the author of the book, entered this dump, and she heard a woman singing. And she thought to herself, how on earth can you sing, in this case, praise the Lord, on this dump? So she went to talk to this woman. And he said, how on earth can you praise the Lord on this dump? And then the answer she gave is remarkable. And that also gives guidance to what I do is, well, it's not the situation that determines how you behave, but how you position yourself opposite to that situation. So what stance do you take? Is it going to be positive or not? Will you play the victim's role? Or will you say, okay, I still see opportunities, even if it's on the dump? Well,
I read a book by Mo Goddard, and he breaks down happiness into a mathematical equation. And he says that your happiness is directly equal to your expectations of events, implying that, a millionaire enjoying or going in a restaurant and getting a meal that is under par from what he expected and is then as a result visibly annoyed by it, even though that same steak to others would be amazing still.
Exactly, exactly. I mean, I also saw a television program just the other day. In Holland, in the Netherlands, children are amongst, well, the happiest in the world. We always are in the rank 1 to 5, somewhere down in that. We also have the highest level of kids with a depression. And not only kids, but consumption of antidepressives.
Yeah.
You hope I
antidepressives,
say I just soaring.
Yeah.
So on the one hand, people are claiming to be happy, and we are amongst that. We have never had so much money at hand to spend, and yet people are depressed.
Mm-hmm.
And that also has to do with all the news about the crisis, nitrogen and climate, and you just name it. So that also puzzles me. How can you be happy on the one hand and see, well, medication that is actually, combating anti-happiness, let's put it that way, soaring?
Mm-hmm.
A bit of paradoxical.
My podcast is called The Quarter Life Crisis. And the reason I called it like this is because for me, as I already briefly mentioned before we started recording, I ended up doing my master. And yet there are so many opportunities out there, so much, like literally, even though I have a sort of very specific marketing, even then I still have a whole world open for me.
Yeah.
My first question is, did you have a quarter life crisis?
Well, yes, yeah, sort of. I think you might call it like that. I mean, when I finished my study, back in 1984, so it's been a long time ago. I mean, I basically had everything I wished for. I already had a wonderful wife. We just got married. I had a first job. I thought a wonderful job. We had a car, a small car. We had an apartment. I thought the nicest apartment I've ever seen. It was really wonderful. And then I thought to myself, okay, so then what's next?
Mm-hmm.
Is then the next step a bigger house?
Mm-hmm.
A larger car, a bigger car? Yeah, so in that case, I sort of may also have, well, I also try to explain, it may also be, at least to some extent, what can be explained from my background. I mean, my parents, they come from a, specifically my father, I mean, from a poor, had a very poor background, so also they wanted the best for us.
Mm-hmm.
And the best is,
mm-hmm,
well, yeah,
big.
Get ready. Yeah, more, and yeah, having also, a better job where you have a higher income.
Mm-hmm.
And the
it's nice to see though then that how you use that sort of, I don't want to call it flaws, but at least his approach on life and took your own spin on it and realized, no, this isn't the road to happiness either.
No.
No.
And that's also what my wife and I also keep telling our children. I mean, they're adults now and. But when they also went to university or wanted to go to university, they also asked, well, but Dad, what then should we do? The eldest daughter, she's a good author. She's a writer also for blogs and what have you, websites and articles, an excellent author. But she also loves horses. That's really her passion.
Okay.
Horses. Great. So I also told her, if that's your passion, we're going to find a course, a curriculum, a school that actually supports your passion.
Yeah.
So Sue went to a vocational school. She was perfectly happy with that. Not with school. I mean, she didn't really like school, but my son and the youngest daughter both studied history. And my youngest daughter, she also asked, well, but should I then do this? Because, yeah, what professions are open to me? I mean, I can become a teacher. Do I then want to become a teacher? Yeah, perhaps, I'm not quite sure. But I also asked her, well, but what then is it what you like? Say, well, I really love to do history. I study history because... And when she started talking about it, I mean, she became more passionate about it. She said, well, this is what you need to do.
Yeah.
This is what you should do. And that's also what I tell my students here. I said, well, sir, should I then... I had several students also asking me after year one or two, I think of quitting my study. Should I do that? And then my answer is, No, don't. Because in the end, you will become something completely different than you were trained for. Because life is full of surprises. A train will come by, you will jump on it, and the other day another train will come by, you will get off the train you initially jumped on, you'll jump on another train, and just enjoy what life will bring you. Mm-hmm. And I also firmly believe that if you follow your passion, in the end, you will also become a passionate professional.
Fascinating. The whole concept of degrowth and what we've spoken about, it's like a goal without a clear end destination. And it seems like the infinite delayed gratification process. First of all, do you believe that is so? And if so, what keeps you motivated to chase that regardless? Is it this caring for other people and trying to incentivize change, or...
Well, it's basically the two elements that I already mentioned. It is, in my view, the only way to go, because if we don't, we will run into a wall sooner or later.
Yeah.
Then that will be a full stop for our economy. So if we really want to improve our economy, or if we want to, then we need to reform it. We have no other option. I mean, if just looking at the economy that we have today, I mean, also didn't. Was not created overnight. We had some sort of a compass, perhaps even an implicit compass, that, well, we need to move in that direction. And I think we need to change that compass now, so we need to move in that direction.
Yeah.
And that's going to create quite some upheaval, because we've never done that before.
Yeah.
We've never done that before. And that's where the exciting part kicks in, because we've never done that before, we also think we can't do it. Mm. Or we starting to fall back on old reflexes. Say, well, but then we need... No, we don't. We're just moving in a different direction, and old reflexes may not help. So we need to reinvent the economy. We need to cherish what really worked and works and what will continue to work, regardless of what system you have. But we also need to move in a different direction. We should not forget. We should not forget. That's one... And we think that this economy, this economy is not, so to speak, God-given. We created this economy. And we took the wrong, in my view, we took the wrong exit sometimes decades ago. So now we need to take the right exit and undo the wrong that we did and start working on the economy that really works for people.
Beautiful. Final question. What is next for you?
In what respect do you mean, what's next for you?
In life, in work, in whatever comes to mind.
What's next to me is setting up a research team, a research hub on degrowth, and promoting the... promoting this. It's going to be hard promoting it. And in life, I mean, if you know what's next to you in life, I mean, I'm 65. I will retire in a year and 8 months.
Mm-hmm.
But I definitely am convinced that I will also continue to go on preaching the gospel of degrowth, let's put it that way, and be also involved in research in that field. If not here in the university, then I will simply do it myself. Yeah, once you're passionate about something, I mean, it doesn't end with retirement.
No. I want to thank you so much for your time. There were several very profound things that you said, and I really appreciate it. And with that being said, thank you.
You're welcome, and thank you for the invitation.